Hey guys, it's Medicosis Perfectionalis, where medicine makes perfect sense. Let's continue our labs playlist. In previous videos, we talked about beta-2 microglobulin. We talked about urine uric acid, urine chloride, urine potassium, urine electrophoresis, Benz-Jones proteins, urine osmolality, and the urine osmolar gap. Then we started talking about the topics of urinalysis, starting with the urine color, urine appearance, urine odor, urine pH, etc. Today it's time to talk about proteins in the urine. Normally there should be almost no proteins in your urine, maybe with the tiny exception of the TAM horsefall protein or uromodula. Other than that, we should not see any proteins in the urine. But what if we saw proteins in the urine? What does that mean? Does it have to be a pathology? Let's find out. Please watch the videos in this playlist in order. A good kidney is a kidney that does not let protein in the urine or blood in the urine. However, a kidney with nephrotic syndrome will let lots of proteins into the urine. Nephritic syndrome, itis means inflammation. This kidney is inflamed and shedding tears of blood into the urine. Normally, we should not see proteins into the urine. Why? Because proteins are here in the blood, okay? They cannot get filtered and end up in the urine for two main reasons. Number one, this glomerular basement membrane has holes and it's called fenestrae. These fenestrations are narrow and the protein is big, so the protein cannot pass through the narrow fenestrations, which means proteins will not end up in your urine. That's normal. Second reason is glomerular basement membrane is negatively charged, and the proteins are also negatively charged. Negative and negative will repel each other. Opposite charges attract, similar charges repel. So for these reasons, we should not see proteins into the urine. Why is TAM horsefall protein an exception? The TAM horsefall protein will have its own separate video. So what are these proteins in my blood? You have albumin and you have globulin. Which one is larger? Globulin. Which one is more abundant? Albumin. If my kidney is starting to show some damage, which one will show up first in the urine? Of course, the smaller one. Albumin will show up first. When you have some albumin in the urine, we call this microalbuminuria. You can also get some microglobulinuria. But then when you have tons of proteins into the urine, this is called overt proteinuria. When they get out of hand, we call them nephrotic-range proteinuria.
Why is having too much protein in my urine a bad thing?
I'll tell you why. Because if you have no proteins for whatever reason, you cannot keep the fluid inside the vessel. Let's draw this out. Here is your vessel right here. Your vessel has plasma proteins. Nice. These plasma proteins are osmotically active. They keep the water around them in the vessel. Is this important? Sure, because this vessel is the one that will perfuse your heart, your brain, and other organs. So it's important to have fluids in the vessel. But let's say that I have kidney disease and I'm starting to lose proteins. The proteins are lost in the urine. Who's gonna keep the fluid inside the vessel? No one. So the fluid will leak outside the vessel, and I will have swelling of my ankles. Or if I am bedridden, swelling of my presacral area, my lower back. If it is so severe, I can get ascites, swelling of my belly. All of that swelling means the fluid is outside the vessel, leaving less fluid inside the vessel, i.e. less perfusion to important vital organs. That's why low proteins in your blood is dangerous. So why do I have low proteins in the blood? It could be because the kidney is losing them. But the kidney is not the only organ that can lose proteins. The gut can lose proteins as well. If it's the stomach's fault, we call it protein-losing gastropathy, such as Ménétrier's disease. If it's the intestine losing the proteins, we call it protein-losing enteropathy, or malabsorption syndrome, such as celiac disease. Or I could be oozing proteins through my skin. This is known as third-degree burns. And I'm not just losing proteins. I'm losing proteins, I'm losing plasma, and I'm losing many electrolytes. And this patient will require that you give them albumin to replace the albumin that they oozed out of the skin. All of these are causes of protein loss, but maybe, I'm not putting protein in. Malnourished, such as kwashiorkor syndrome, protein energy malnutrition. Or maybe my liver cannot make albumin or globulin, so decreased protein synthesis can be seen in cirrhosis. Regardless of the cause of the low protein in the blood, at the end of the day, I can get edema that is pitting dependent on gravity, is a transudate, not an exudate, due to decreased oncotic pressure, not due to increased hydrostatic pressure or capillary permeability. More fluid outside the vessel equals less fluid inside the vessel equals less effective arterial blood volume, which can lead to hypoperfusion. We talked about nephrotic syndrome before in details in my nephrology playlist. Remember the four features of nephrotic syndrome? High protein in my urea, low protein in my emia, edema and hyperlipidemia. I'm losing all kinds of proteins in the urine. When I lose albumin, the oncotic pressure drops, I get edema and hypoperfusion. When I lose antithrombin 3, I lost the antithrombin, so I became more thrombotic, I can get clots. When I lose my immunoglobulins, I get infections. Recall that all of your lipoproteins, LDL, HDL, VLDL, IDL, have a protein portion and a lipid portion. When you lose the protein portion, you will lead to dyslipidemia. That was nephrotic syndrome collectively. However, it can have individual diseases such as minimal change disease, focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, membranous nephropathy, diabetes, or diabetic nephropathy, and amyloidosis. Each one of these topics has its own separate video in my nephrology playlist. Is urine dipstick the most accurate way of finding proteins into the urine? No, but it's the cheapest way and the easiest way. Otherwise, the patient will have to collect urine over a 24-hour period, which is easier said than done, especially in the pediatric or the geriatric population. But let's try the urine dipstick. I did the urine dipstick, okay, and I found proteins in the urine. What's the next step?
Panic and tell the patient that they have multiple myeloma.
Shut up. Repeat the test. The test is not accurate in the first place. When you repeat the test twice, you're increasing the chance that whatever the test is saying is actually correct. If you found no proteinuria the second time, then the odds are that the first proteinuria was not true. It was a false positive. I've told you it's not a very accurate test. No medicosis, I still found proteinuria. So you got proteinuria twice. Now let's take it seriously. It will be really good if one of the tests was done in the morning and one was done in the evening. Because if there is too much protein at the end of the day and less protein in the morning, this is called what? Orthostatic proteinuria. The more you walk or the more time you're left standing up, more proteins are showing up in the urine. It's called orthostatic proteinuria. That's not a disease. Or it could be that it doesn't matter whether it's morning or night, the proteinuria is the same. Now, this is worrisome. Probably a kidney's fault. Okay, who should I blame? Should I blame the glomerulus of the kidney or the tubules of the kidney? If you find lots of microalbumin in the urine, blame the glomerulus because it's the glomerulus that has the glomerular basement membrane, which has the negative charges and the small fenestrations under normal circumstances. But if you find beta 2 microglobulin in the urine, then blame the tubules. If you want to learn more about beta 2 microglobulin, I have a specific video on this topic in my labs playlist. Proteinuria definitions by the dipstick, by measuring it in a 24-hour urine. And what does that correspond to in terms of concentration, i.e. mass per volume? When the urine dipstick tells you this is 1 plus proteinuria, this is around 300 milligrams per day. So if you ask this patient to bring urine of an entire day, you'll find 300 milligrams in the entire urine sample.
Is this abnormal?
Yes.
What's the normal?
Less than 150 milligrams per day.
Oh, so this is like more than double.
Yes. And this corresponds to 30 milligrams per deciliter. Why is that? What's a deci? A deci of anything is 1/10. So if I have 30 milligrams in 1/10 of a liter, how much do you think I have in 1 liter?
30 times 10 is 300.
Perfect. And what's the normal urine volume in a day? About 1 liter, 1.5 liter, something like this. So if we say 1 liter, you just take a zero off of here and you get the answer here.
Oh, that's easy.
Or you multiply this by 10, from 30 you get 300. And you'll find the same pattern repeated again and again and again, because medicine makes so much sense once you understand what the flip you're talking about. It's called basic math, people. What if the urine dipstick told me it's 2 plus proteinuria? Then we expect 1,000 milligrams per day, which is way worse than 1 plus, and this corresponds to about 100 milligrams per deciliter. If you call the first one microalbuminuria, you call the second one macroalbuminuria. How about 3 plus on the dipstick, 3,000 milligrams per day, or 300 milligrams per deciliter. And it's at this point that the patient will start to suffer symptoms, such as symptoms of edema, ankle edema, presacral edema, ascites, periorbital puffiness, etc. If it's 4+, now that is really bad. That's more than 3,500 milligrams per day. You can also say 4,000 milligrams per day. No one cares at this point. And the urine protein is about 2,000 milligrams per liter or above. And this is called nephrotic range proteinuria. This is very severe. This is a patient who is not just having edema, but thromboses, infections, which may include peritonitis. This patient will suffer from hyperlipidemia. And when you look in the urine, you might see lipid casts, also known as fatty casts, Maltese crosses, and oval fat bodies. Do you remember my video on the urine casts? What does a cast mean? It means a block. Just like by seeing a block of ice that is shaped like a cube, I can guess the shape of the container of the ice. It was made of cubes. Similarly, when you see cast in the urine that looks like tubules, you can blame the tubules of the kidney, not the bladder. Do not blame the urethra. The problem is coming from the kidney tubules because I saw these shapes, these casts, these blocks in the urine. If I have nephrotic syndrome, I'll see fatty casts in the urine with Maltese crosses, as well as oval fat bodies. Remember the types of urine casts? We had hyaline or cellular. Hyaline are also known as proteinaceous. They are made of proteins. So I can see some protein in the urine, namely the TEM horsefold protein or uromodulin. And in some cases, this is physiologic, such as standing for a long time or orthostatic proteinuria, strenuous exercise or stress. Or it could be a disease, such as proteinuria, chronic kidney disease, etc. As for the nephrotic range, it usually has some fatty casts with it. This is seen in nephrotic syndrome, fat emboli, glomerulonephritis, and mercury poisoning. In case of nephrotic syndrome, you see these fatty or lipid casts with Maltese crosses and oval fat bodies. Urine protein, let's go. There is the spot dipstick, which is just one urine sample. Hey patient, give me some urine right now. I'm taking that urine to the lab. That's a spot test. This is the dipstick. You don't even have to take it to the lab. It has indicators on the cup that can tell you basically roughly how much protein is there. If you want the more accurate one, you need 24-hour urine, which means urine in a day, and you send this to the lab. What's the normal protein in the urine? If it's a spot urinalysis or spot dipstick, we expect to be no protein in the urine, but it's acceptable up to 8 milligrams per deciliter.
Not the 300 milligrams per deciliter that you just talked about. No.
Normally, it should be almost nothing. How about in a 24-hour sample? It should be between 50 and 80 milligrams per day during rest. But if you're exercising, we expect more proteins into the urine, so we will allow it to rise, but not to exceed 250 milligrams per deciliter. Above this, we start thinking of pathology, not just a person exercising. This was the normal. Now let's talk about the abnormal. Abnormal means what? Abnormal means tons of protein in the urine, so expect this to be 300, 3000, you name it. And of course, this will be way higher than this number. So what are the causes of too much protein in the urine? Could be physiologic, could be pathologic. And what do I mean by too much protein in the urine? I mean above 300 milligrams per 24 hours. Let's go. Physiological causes include standing for too long, police officers, security guards, neurosurgeons, any surgeons, ushers, Gordon Ramsay, etc. Any person who stands up for too long can get proteinuria. That's not a disease. Strenuous exercise, stress, cold baths. So if you take cold baths, make sure to tell the doctor, hey, I take cold baths, because you'll find some protein in the urine. And if I'm dehydrated, it can increase proteins in the urine. Protein-rich diet can increase protein in the urine. Too much protein in the blood, too much protein in the urine. Next, pathological causes of proteinuria. Usually the proteinuria here is more severe than here by the numbers. Nephrotic syndrome has to be here, which can be caused by diabetic nephropathy, amyloid nephropathy, minimal change disease, focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, and many others. Or it could be nephritic syndrome. Yes, nephritic is more about blood in the urine, but you can also see protein in the urine. Can lupus lead to this? Yeah, lupus can lead to nephritic or nephrotic. Lupus is a disaster for the kidney. Or it could be polycystic kidney disease. This is a disease where I have tons of cysts in the kidneys, which can lead to hypertension and can also lead to proteinuria. And when it leads to hypertension, oh, by the way, hypertension itself can lead to proteinuria. Preeclampsia, or the one with seizures, eclampsia, destroy the kidney and can lead to proteinuria. Multiple myeloma, tons of Bence-Jones proteins into the urine. These are the light chains of the antibody, because multiple myeloma is cancer of plasma cells that make antibodies. Too many antibodies equals too many heavy chains and too many light chains. Light chains in the urine are called Bence-Jones proteins. Heavy metal poisoning destroys kidneys and can lead to proteins in the urine. Trauma to the kidney. Congestive heart failure traumatizes the kidney by means of depriving the kidney of its arterial perfusion, because all of the fluid is not in the artery. It's in your ankles. It's in your jugular vein. It's in your belly, etc. Urethritis, prostatitis, and all of these infections can also lead to protein in the urine, because remember, what is itis-itis? Acute inflammation, itis-itis, pay attention. Redness, hotness, swelling, pain, loss of function. Ruber, calor, tumor, dollar, functional assay. And what are the cells of acute inflammation? Neutrophils. Do they leave debris behind them?
Of course they leave debris.
What's that debris?
Mostly proteins and stuff?
Yeah, proteins in the urine. Inflammation. Bacterial products, neutrophil products, etc. Also, if I run a marathon while being dehydrated, I can get myoglobinuria. Myoglobin is a protein, so this is a cause of proteinuria. Hemoglobinuria can also lead to proteinuria. You see hemoglobinuria in cases of intravascular hemolysis. And we have discussed this topic extensively in my hematology playlist, where we talked about all the anemias. Do we have medications that can lead to proteinuria? Of course, acetazolamide, lithium, salicylates, and then many antibiotics. And don't forget the antifungals. Next, some pearls for the pros. You see this Bence-Jones proteins? Yeah. It might or might not be detected by the stupid, cheap urine dipstick test. If you want the accurate diagnosis, send the sample to the lab for a more elaborate diagnosis. Looking at a stupid indicator on a stupid cup might not be the best way to diagnose a disease, but it's cheap. Next, what is urine protein to urine creatinine ratio? You measure the proteins in the urine and creatinine in the urine. Let's talk about normal, okay? Normally, should we see proteins in the urine? No. Normally, should we see creatinine in the urine?
Of course, yes. Creatinine is waste. It should go outside the body.
All right. So normally, the numerator is so tiny, almost non-existent, and the denominator is significant, which means the normal ratio is so tiny, less than 0.15. This is normal. Abnormal is when it exceeds this, usually more than 0.2 or 0.3 or 0.4. That will be not good. The greater the ratio, the worse the proteinuria, which could be caused by any of these. Proteinuria in the pediatric population. Well, since this depends on the size of the baby, this is defined as protein they are more than 100 milligrams per square meter, i.e. the body's surface area, per 24-hour period. Urine dipstick is way easier in pediatrics, but it's less accurate. Collecting urine in 24-hour period is harder, however, it's more accurate. Why do you call the dipstick less accurate all the time? It has many causes of false positive or false negatives. If the urine sample is just concentrated or alkaline or has some or whatever, or contaminated with anything, will give me proteinuria when in fact the baby is healthy. And then the more accurate 24-hour urine has a problem. It's difficult to collect 24-hour urine in children. So what can I do instead of that? You can do the ratio. Protein to creatinine ratio. Protein in the urine over creatinine in the urine. The normal ratios depend on the age, and there are tables that pediatricians need to be familiar with. Preeclampsia and eclampsia can lead to kidney disease and proteinuria during pregnancy. You can learn more about preeclampsia, eclampsia, gestational diabetes, infants of diabetic mothers, twin-twin transfusion syndrome, and much more by downloading my OBGYN high yields course at medicosisperfectionalis.com. Many toxins can destroy the kidney and can lead to renal tubular acidosis, proteinuria, and other disasters. You can download my toxicology course at medicosisperfectionalis.com. To learn about the normal kidney function, the glomerular filtration rate, renal plasma flow, what is titratable acidity, the function of the loop of Henle, the countercurrent multiplier, exchanger, and much more, download my renal physiology course. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe, hit the bell, and click on the join button. You can support me here or here. Go to my website to download my courses. Be safe, stay happy, study hard. This is Medicosis Perfectionalis, where medicine makes perfect sense.